Okay, so you run a nonprofit organization. Your organization is growing. More volunteers, more donors, more projects, more everything. That's great, but when things start to grow, it becomes overwhelming, and it's hard to keep track of everything. You know you need some more powerful software, but you're not much of a computer whiz. And all the cloud technology out there seems like it's made for big companies, not nonprofit organizations. Wouldn't it be great if someone could harness all this powerful cloud technology and use it for good? Introducing Cloud for Good, the team of cloud technology experts that speak fluent nonprofit. At Cloud for Good, we translate your needs into technology, providing you with the best tools so you can work smarter and faster and do more good. How? Well, first we learn everything we can about your organization. Then, we create a design document based on everything we learned, along with our years of experience. Next, we customize your system and integrate it with your website or other databases, and migrate your existing data to the new system. Then, we train your team, and even provide ongoing support. We help you implement strategic solutions, so you can increase your fundraising, better manage your volunteers and events, measure your program outcomes, and do more good. Cloud for Good. It's all about your mission. Get your organization on the cloud today at cloudforgood.com.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Tal Frankfurt, and I'm the founder and CEO of Cloud for Good. If you cannot see my screen, please put your message in the chat window so we can get a result for you as soon as possible. The webinar today is part of a series of webinars Cloud for Good is offering at no cost to the nonprofit community. The webinars can be found on our website under the resource tab, then webinars, and you can find basically the registration to all our Apps for Good webinar series, where we basically host different app exchange providers that develop applications that either work specifically for nonprofits or can enhance the Nonprofit Starter Pack. We had our first webinar last week with Cirrus Insight. We're going to have additional webinars with Click and Pledge for online donations, Congo Composer for mail merge, CauseView for fundraising, foundation applications, Volunteers for Salesforce, event management, management auctions for Salesforce, GeoPoint, and many more. So if you have not done yet, please go to our website and register for additional webinars with us. Today I have on the line with me Hillary Walker from FormAssembly. FormAssembly is probably one of the most powerful online form integrations for Salesforce. We use it internally at Cloud for Good, and many of our clients are using FormAssembly, so we thought it would be a great opportunity to share it with the rest of the world. So Hillary, are you here?
Yes, I am, and I have Deborah with me also. Hi. I'm going to allow Deborah to start off telling you about some stuff, and then I'll join in and give a demonstration in a little bit. Tal, are you ready for us to take off?
Go for it.
All right. So, hi, Deborah, and I'll be talking first to tell you a little bit about FormAssembly. Theo actually started FormAssembly because when he was working in the IT department at a university, he realized how time-consuming it was to make forms from scratch, especially complex forms where you're handling a lot of data. So we definitely understand where you're coming from, and we're really proud to help nonprofits and educational organizations, and we hope we can help you too. All right, so here you can see that FormAssembly isn't just a form builder. Not only do we integrate with Salesforce, but we've also got payment integrations for things like donation forms and Microsoft Excel, and Google Spreadsheets integration, so you can export your data. Down at the bottom, you can also see a few of our nonprofit customers. And thanks to Jonathan Mayer, who's the Salesforce System Administrator at Fresno Pacific University, I can give you an example of how FormAssembly is used in colleges and universities. Now Fresno Pacific University used to use both paper forms and standalone survey tools, which meant that there was no integration with Salesforce. So the staff would always have to deal with double entry. With paper forms, they'd have to collect the paper form, retype that form, and put it into Salesforce, or they had to deal with a lot of copying and pasting with their survey tools, which meant there would be frequent errors in the process. And so the staff were also putting in a lot of extra time just to collect and organize information to make sure everything was in the right place. So here's how the staff were able to use FormAssembly as their solution. They automated these processes by using FormAssembly forms, which integrate directly with Salesforce. So they didn't have to re-enter anything. They would just let students fill out forms, and the responses would instantly show up in Salesforce. And since the staff could compare the new data with the existing data, they could tell right away if there were errors. And even better, the staff could pre-fill the forms with information from Salesforce. For example, if they sent out an email to a student to ask them to update their contact information, the form would already have the student's existing address and phone number pulled straight from Salesforce, so it's easier for the student to fill out the form because they didn't have to enter in that information. Okay, so let's give you a closer look at a specific case study so you can see what an automated survey workflow would look like once it's set up. Fresno Pacific University wanted to make their tutoring center feedback automatic so they could get feedback right after a student attended a tutoring session. And the staff wanted it to be as easy as possible for the student to fill out the form. So the staff created a form with FormAssembly and connected it to Salesforce. So here's the Salesforce record for a student who just attended a tutoring session called New Tutoring Interaction. You can see how the status says attended, and you can see the appointment start and end time. And so once this is entered into Salesforce, this will set off a trigger to send an email to the student. And here's the email that the student would get. You can see where the information has been pulled from Salesforce, the student's name, the tutor name, and the appointment time. And here's a link to the FormAssembly form. So when the student clicks that link, they can see the form here with the university's branding at the top. It's a very simple form, as you can see. This is also an example of form without any identifying info. And it doesn't need to ask for the student's name or number because all that information is already in the Salesforce database. So with the form filled out, the student clicks submit. And then once they click that submit button, you'll be able to see on your end in Salesforce that the survey data is instantly available. You can see the student's rating scores and then see the student's explanation for the scores right there. So to recap, here are the basic steps of the workflow. Number one, you update the Salesforce record once the student is done with the tutoring session, which triggers an email to the student. And when the student fills out the form, the info goes right back into Salesforce. Hopefully you can see how this workflow would save you a lot of time. You won't have to send out individual emails or collect the forms or even retype anything because that's being done for you. And that's it for the case study. If you have any questions after this webinar is over, you can contact support@formassembly.com. or ask Jared at FormAssembly.com for more information if you're interested in trying out FormAssembly. As a nonprofit, you can get 3 months free off our basic or professional plans, or 20% off our enterprise plan. All right, and thank you very much. Now I'll hand it over to Hillary.
Great, thank you, Deborah, and thank you, Tal. Let me go ahead and move a few things around here. Okay, so now we know what FormAssembly can do. I'm going to show you a little bit deeper into the integration, and I'm going to show you how to use FormAssembly, the form builder and the connector. First, you want to know, how do you access FormAssembly? Of course, you can go to formassembly.com, but as Tal said earlier, we also have our AppExchange app. This is what we look like in Salesforce. You can see the screen cuts off a little bit, but we do have this full screen button over here that opens you right up into the larger app, just right in the website itself. Now, the integration is the same whether you are accessing FormAssembly.com or if you're accessing through Salesforce. Okay, so how do we integrate? Well, our team has built what we call a connector. The Salesforce connector allows you to automatically export the data you submitted with your form into your Salesforce.com account. Once you've logged into FormAssembly, you're taken to our Form Manager. This is the Form Manager. It shows you any forms that you've already created. If you don't have any, it's easy to start one. We can go to our Template tab right here. And to the right, you will see the featured templates that our team has created and provided for your use. There are connectors that go to PayPal, Capsule CRM, Salesforce. So there's a variety in here. Now on the left are connectors that we have created and also our user base has created. You'll see here's one for MailChimp down here. We have all kinds of different stuff. And if you like your form and you want to share it with the world, you also can do that. Oops. Okay. So you can also start a form with the New Form button. Or you can import a form from Salesforce. There are some limitations here. So it's good to be able to know how to use the connector and, of course, the form builder. We're going to start with a form that I have started already, just a few fields on it, called our hometown catering form. We're going to open that in our form builder. Okay, so here you see that we have some fields. These are all contact fields, and we're going to hook them up to our contact object. But I've also created a custom object for our catering quote or orders that we're going to receive from this form. First, I'm going to add a couple fields just so you can get a feel of what using our form builder is like. I'm going to start off with a radio button. Now I can tab to go to the next line. You'll have to bear with me on my typing and my talking. I'm getting better, but I don't think you can get great at doing those two things at once. All right, so now you see I just drug that field up here and drag it back down. I can also rearrange the choices. Okay. Now, if we want that required, we can click on it. Selecting it brings up our toolbar or editing toolbar, and we can make it required as easy as that. Okay, let's add a few more fields. We're going to add a text input field. This is going to be our event date. Our serving time. And estimated attendance. I have to spell it out, and I still got it wrong. All right. Now you see we have a variety of fields up here that I've been using. We're going to choose our text. This gives a little larger view. Multiple lines available here. And we're just going to say comments. And one last field we're going to use today is our file upload. And you notice as soon as I choose the field type, the field is dropped onto the page and I start typing immediately. We have another option is themes. Here we can choose one that our team's provided for you, or we can choose a custom theme. This one went a little bit skinny. So up here in the properties, we have a lot of different options as well. We're going to change the form width right here, very easy. There we go. And let's save. Here to go ahead and leave the form builder for right now and make our way to the connector. We have a connector tab along with these other tabs, give you many options in the processing of your form or the availability to share with everyone or share with other people individually. Going to our connector tab, we are going to configure our connector. Using the Salesforce version 2. And it never keeps the same or the correct password, so let me type that password in. Now we also need our security token. You don't need your security token if you define the ranges in your profile, or you can just use your security token. I'm copying mine and pasting and checking. All right, it worked. So here we're going to go ahead and enable it right now because I have a bad habit during a demo. If I don't enable it at the beginning, we'll wonder why it doesn't work once I save it. So skipping ahead and enabling that. And we're going to start with our first object, which is our contact object. We select it from the list available. Now the profile you place right here and fill this in for is going to be what you see when you look at the schema. That determines what objects are available, what fields are available. We're selecting always create a new record and confirm. Last name is required when doing a contact object creation. So we have to definitely map that field. Now the other we have that are available, we have the first name. So let's go ahead and pick the first name. The phone, I'm going to go with a mobile phone, and the email. Okay, confirm, confirm, confirm. Let's go ahead and save it just to be good. All right. Now down at the bottom next to the Save button, we have some options down here. Feedback, we're always welcome to take your feedback. Just make sure you send us some information. If you don't have questions, we'd love to hear what you think could improve FormAssembly. So it's always available to get to easily. Send us some information. Okay, and here we have our View Salesforce Schema link. The object I created is called the request object. This is a custom object you can see with the C here. And you'll see the fields that I created on the form earlier, along with some other fields. Let's go ahead and map the request field. So I'm selecting the request custom object, always creating. Mapping your first field, we're going to go with the event date. Serving time. Estimated attendance. And comments. Okay. Now there's one more field that I added besides the image field. We're going to work with that in just a moment. But I also added the this is an order or quote field. We're going to map that to our record type ID. Down here you'll see we have send as choices, as we call them. And we're just going to get the record IDs from within Salesforce and paste them in here. You want to make sure there's no spaces attached to things that you paste. And confirm. All right, great. We're going to take another look at the schema. you'll see here that I have a customer field. The ID of a contact is what this is saying. So it's referring to the contact object, and it will only accept an ID, just as the event date field will only accept the date. So mapping another field, we have the customer field. And that is not going to be linked to a field in the form. Instead, we're going to link it to the ID of an object above. We only have one, so it makes it fairly easy to guess right now that that's going to be our contact object. So we're defining the relationship between the contact object and the new request object. All right, let's save again. All right, now I'm going to go ahead and add one more object here. Let me show you. Oops, those are not on the right page. Okay. So here I have a little flowchart. The user submits the form, and it's going through the Salesforce connector. We've created a contact. We're going to create a request. And last is the create attachment. So when working with an attachment, this is actually another object as far as Salesforce is concerned at this point. So we have the create new request object, and we want it to be linked to the request. So anytime a request is created and there's an image in the form also, it's going to be linked to the request. So we're going to add a dependent object onto the request. Now, as I said, an attachment is another object. So here, it's just asking which holds the parent, the reference to the parent. And it's required. As you can see right here, this is actually going to disappear. There we go. So that might be a little confusing, but once you do it yourself, you may feel a little more at ease with it. It just needs to be mapped one way or another. So that's just one option. The file name and the body are both going to be mapped to the same thing, the event image. Okay. I'm going to save. All right. And we're going to go ahead and test. Let's go back to the connector list. This will give us the option to open the form and test it. I'll go to the Publish tab, which shows the link your form is available live at. I'm going to open that up in another tab. All right. So here's our form. Excuse me. I'm going to create an order. And let's say I'm going to use Jim Doe. His email, I'm going to use today's date. There we go. And a phone number. Event date. Now, you can choose to use a validation of a calendar on this field. Where the calendar pops up, which is a great idea if it's a date that is relatively close. So let's say 7/4. Who doesn't want to have a party on July 4th? Okay, serving time, we'll say 4 p.m. Estimated attendance 200, and we have many, many comments. Let's choose a file. All right, and submit. We have a generic message that's available. This is it right here. Thank you. Your response has been processed successfully. You may, of course, change this message or redirect to another page. Users using our Salesforce connector are also on a plan that allows you to redirect depending upon a multiple choice field on the form as well. So it's great to make a dynamic workflow. Okay. So here we go. We are in Salesforce. We're going to go to our requests. So this should be the most recent one. Yep, July 4th. That's the event date I chose. Here's Jim Doe. I chose order, so the record type did work. Down here, you'll see that we do have an attachment at the bottom of the screen. And the other thing you'll notice is the customer field. You can click on that and go directly to Jim Doe's contact record. And then down here, you can also go the other direction and go from the contact record to the request record. All right. So next, I'm going to show you how to update a Salesforce record. So we're going to make a change. It's a small change. We're going to change the contact creation to an update. The connector is going to do a lookup. And then depending on how many matches are found, it's going to update or create. So just a quick mention, if there are two or more matches, we're going to have it create. The reason is because the connector does not know how to decide if a record with the same parameters that you've supplied, you know, it can't judge which one would be a better fit. So in this case, you can either create a contact or the other choices, which are skip or just cancel the connector processing altogether. Okay. So let's go back into the connector and configure. And right here, we have create a new contact. We're going to change that to update an existing record. So now that we're going to update, we have to define a lookup. We're going to select a Salesforce field. In most cases, it is easiest to use the email field, as it is not going to be duplicated between different people. But sometimes you need a little bit more than that, maybe. But an email is a great field to use because it is unique to an individual 99% of the time. Okay, and this is going to equal a field in our form and an email field. So email in Salesforce equals email on the field. You can add additional conditions. But if they leave the field empty, it's going to match anything that leaves it empty. So you want to be careful of how many conditions you want to add. Sometimes less is more, less is better. Okay, we talked about this just a second ago. We're only updating if one record is found. Otherwise, we're going to create a new record and confirm. So let's go ahead and save this. To the connector list again. This will allow us to go that live link. And we're going to fill this out one more time. I'm not going to just say one more time. I may trick you. You might have to do it again. Or I may have to do it again. Not you. All right, so let's see. Jimmy Doe. Last time it was Jim Doe. This time it is Jimmy Doe. Same email is going to be used because that's what we're looking up. And let's say event date. We're going to go with the same date. Okay, and submit. So what's changed here? Jimmy? Same email. So what we're doing is we're finding this email. We're going to update it so it says Jimmy. We're always creating a new request record. and a new attachment record. So this information at the bottom half is going to still create new. We're only updating the contact object, the contact record. All right, so update. And again, it's successful. And moving over to Jim Doe's contact record, I'm just going to reload this page. All right, there you go, Jimmy Doe. Now we've added another request. So it's the same person, but they're making different orders or different quotes. So the multiple orders and quotes show up down here. Okay, now next, I'm going to show you a little bit of pre-filling. This is something that a lot of our users, a lot of our customers do, just as Deborah had showed you a moment ago. It makes for a very easy way to go ahead and let the people update. They can say, yes, that's my address, or no, that's not my address. I need to update it if that's what you'd like to do. What we're going to do is we're going to say that this form is only for people that you've specifically sent an email to. They're already a contact in your organization. And we are going to send the contact ID through the email templates in Salesforce. We're going to use their mail merge. And so once, if I don't know if you've used the Salesforce email templates before, but what happens is you can use their mail merge for fields, just as you can do in Word documents and Excel. And as Salesforce send those emails out, they're going to fill the information in. So in this case, we're going to use a contact ID. It's going to throw the contact ID in the placeholder that we say we want the contact ID. And we're not going to have to do a contact lookup. Okay, so I'm going to make a copy of this form right here. It's going to open up in the form builder. Here's a tutorial that you can take when you first come into the form builder. We do have free accounts. So if you want to just play around in the form builder and see how it feels, you can sign up for a free account. Take our tutorials and video tutorials we also have. Okay, so right now we are going to get rid of all the contact fields. Oops, wrong button. Simply, right now, we don't need them in this scenario. Okay, but we do need an additional field. We're going to make this a hidden field. So you saw the customer field that we used earlier. Okay, the customer field we used earlier. We're going to make that field now on the form. We have a preview right here. As you can see, the hidden field is not visible. But we do want to use the hidden field in testing. We want to be able to see it. So I'm going to go to our blue options button. This opens up all of our options, features. And we are going to change the question type to a single line text field. So it's a text field just like these other text fields you see here. And as you can see in the preview, you can see it. And let's save. And let's leave. We're going to go into the connector and make a few changes there. Now this form was copied. It does copy the connector. We just have to log into it. And this is something that could be changing the way we log in, so you don't have to do this every time, but not quite yet. Still need to do it every time. Okay, getting my security token. Okay. Now, what we're going to do here is we're going to get rid of the contact update. So we're just getting rid of it here. Remove this object. So now we just have the request and the attachment. We have the customer field, and if you remember, right here, we had the reference to the contact step that was above, but we've deleted the contact step, so now there's nothing. We need to fill that in. We're going to use a field in the form now. We created the customer field on the form. There we go, and confirm. And save. Let's jump back over to Salesforce. Now that we have our form and our connector set up, we're going to come over here to the Salesforce setup, go to the email templates, my templates, and I created one for today just so we can skip over the Salesforce stuff, getting ready to make it. Excuse me. So here we have our preview of the HTML template. This is for people that allow pretty emails to come into their inbox. You also have to make a text template for people that do not allow pretty emails into their inbox. So in the middle, we're going to go ahead and edit this HTML version. In the middle, we want to put a link that they can click on. Let me come back over here to our form properties. We need to be able to tell them where the form is. So in the Publish tab, we have our form address. We're going to copy that. And I'm going to paste it right there. And back over here in FormAssembly, at the bottom of the Publish tab, we have a link that says Show How to Pre-fill Form Data Dynamically. So clicking here, you'll see our fields that we've put in the form. And up here is a link to show how to pre-fill. So here's the form link right here, and it's followed by a question mark. It kind of says the stuff before the question mark is the location, and the stuff after the question mark is what we want to do to the form. So over here, we need a question mark. Okay. And we come back over here. We need the customer field. The bottom one, TFA14_14. So I'm going to type that over here, TFA_14. So that says, in the customer field, I want, and the equal sign. So now we need to say what we want. The available merge fields is going to be the tool that will help us here. We have the contact field, exactly what we're looking for, and we want the contact ID. So here it says the merge field value. I'm going to go ahead and copy that and paste. I'm going to make sure there's no spaces. Spaces are not your friend in these sort of things. Okay. Now, as I said before, when we decide to send the emails out, as Salesforce sends them out, it's going to put in the contact ID of those who you specify. So a lot of you may say, as many of our customers have emailed us and said, but I don't want this ugly link showing up in the pretty email. So we're going to copy that. And right down here, of course, normally you wouldn't have both of them, but for testing and showing you how it works, I'm going to leave the ugly one there. I'm going to say insert link. And we're just going to paste it right here. Oops, I forgot something. Okay, that was just another ugly link. We're going to say click here. There we go. All right, this will work this time. There's a link button up here. And paste. Okay, click here. Let's go ahead and save this. Now, just before we save, I want to make sure to mention that you can do this with any field. So if you want to pre-fill a form that will put in an address or anything like that, just take it field by field. Remember, you just have the location of the form, Then you have the question mark. And then go field by field. And we do have more documentation on this as well. So now we're going to go ahead and save. Where's the save? There's the save. All right, here's our preview. We're going to send a test and verify the merge fields. So let's look up here. We'll go with John Bond. Sounds nifty. All right, we're going to send a preview email to myself so we can look at that as well. And remember, Salesforce also has documentation on how to use their mail merge as well. Okay, let me check my email. And here you see the cratering request link. This was the name of the template I created. And we have the click here. Now, this is a reason right here why we should put it in the links, but there's other ways around this as well. It kind of breaks the URL. URLs are somewhat finicky, so this is a great idea to put it in the link as we did here. Now let's click here, and we will see what it looks like. The customer field should be hidden, but in this case for testing, we unhit it, and there is the contact ID. So let's say we're going to go ahead and fill this out. Serving time, we'll say 6, estimated attendance. Let's go ahead and submit. All right, great. Oh, I'm in the wrong one. I wanted to go to Salesforce. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and come to the request. Mr. Bond. I lost Mr. Bond. John Bond. Okay, so down here we have the request for John Bond. And we have the request right here linking to the customer. Now we didn't do a contact lookup, but we fed in the contact ID, so it was automatically defining that relationship. So a great thing to look at here is the log. Let me show you the log.
Hillary? Hi. Well, I just want to jump in really quick and say that we have a lot of questions coming up, so I just want to make sure that we leave some time for questions and answers.
Yeah, this is actually, I have about a minute left.
Great.
All right, so here's one of the forms that we've used, and this is the log. It shows you the steps that it took. So right here we have created a contact record, created a request, and created an attachment. It gives you the record ID for each one. And the second one here starts with the lookup. It found the lookup, it updated the record, and so on. So you can always look at the log if you need to verify a contact ID or another record ID that you're working with, or if you know that there's an error, you can look into the log, which also will let you resend if you need to make some modifications, or you can view the response in FormAssembly, which also has the log at the bottom. All right, so let's go with some questions. I'm sure that we have.
So first question I see here is it possible to add a text below the question? So for example, if they would like to explain the question, so kind of a help text.
Oh, yes. Okay, so real quick here, let me show you. I use this first name field, going to options. That is one of our features over on our sidebar. So here's the hint. You can type it in here, And then below is actually the best in terms of usability. People's eyes read and fill out forms better if everything is in a straight line down, right, like it is here. So placing the hint below is going to give that same ease to the user's eyes.
Great. And another question that I have here is, can you will it accept dates from a calendar? So the date around the date field, can you add a little calendar there?
Absolutely.
And can you add validation so it won't take an email on a date field, for example?
Oh, absolutely. Right here we have the date field, and again, the options, blue option button. Our first one is a validation. Probably the first one because people use a lot of validation. We validate for emails. We validate for dates. We have two options, with a calendar and without. Again, if the date is not relatively close, you probably want to not use the calendar. So there's the date with the calendar. And we can see that in the live form, actually. You can't see that in the preview. But, yes, it does work.
Cool. Can you create multiple pages, so like page one and page two of the form, and then can you move fields from page one to page two and vice versa?
Absolutely. Up here we have add content. Besides the fields that you've seen me use today, you can group things into sections for organizational, your own use, or even with a border. But here we have pages. So here's create a second page. Up top, you'll see jump to one and two. We can switch pages. Now, let's say we want to put these event questions on the other page. Well, you can drag it up to the one and two up there, or you can drag them down here in our outline view. The outline view is greater for getting a larger view of the form. If you have a big form, this is a much easier way to move your fields around. I know some people have 30, 50 pages in their form, so it can be pretty intense.
Great. A repeated question here is, what type of licenses do people need in order to complete the form? Do they need something like a customer portal? How does it work?
Not at all. The form link is live. If your form is active, that link is live, and anyone can access it. You can use an authentication. If you're a Salesforce customer, you can use the portal authentication. We also have LDAP authentication. And that's something, if you have more questions on how that works, you can email support or email Jarrett. He's our business development guy. He's also sales, so somebody good to talk to about that type of setup.
Great. I have a question here about click and pledge integration for payment processing. So will the form integrate with click and pledge? And I believe that the answer is no. Right, Hillary?
I've never tried to set one of those up. I would have to look into it further. With our HTTP connector, you can set a lot of integrations up that we don't have as defined integrations. They don't have their own connector. Like for MailChimp, for instance, you can use our HTTP connector. So I've never tried click and pledge myself, so I can't give a definite answer there.
Okay. You showed us earlier when you published a form that it created a URL for the form. Can you customize this form? Can you define it?
No, you cannot. But what you can do is you can embed the form into your own site in a multiple of ways. You can copy the HTML here in a full page or snippet format, or you can use various ways of REST API to publish the form. So there are other options.
Great. I have a question that we also get from a lot of our clients. Can you send, so I have basically, they give a scenario here. They want to send a form to all their donors with some of the information already pre-filled, like first name, last name, and email. So the donor can just review the information, or your constituent or your student can just review the information and update it.
Absolutely. That was that's actually the exact scenario that Deborah was showing earlier.
Right.
So take a look at that part of it again, and when we have the video that you can review this demo, which is great, by the way. Not the demo, but the fact that you can review it.
The demo's good, too.
But, yeah, so absolutely, that's totally possible, just in the same way that I showed earlier, too.
Yeah, and also someone said that they couldn't really follow every step, and so I want to highlight again that this webinar is recorded, plus there's tons of documentation on the FormAssembly forums. Another interesting question here. Can you integrate an approval process into a form creation? So I'm assuming one person, and Helen, correct me if I'm wrong, it's your question, one person will create the form and another person will need to approve it before they go live with it?
On our enterprise edition of FormAssembly, this is possible. We call it our moderation. We use it to make sure that people don't abuse our forms for phishing and stuff like that. So. You can have it set so all forms can go through moderation, and then the moderator or the administrator, whoever has that responsibility, has a list of forms that they can look at and then approve or deny them.
Great. I have a question here from a nonprofit rock star, David Habib. What is the cost for nonprofits?
The cost for nonprofits is more or less the same, but we do offer a discount. So on our Enterprise Edition, it's depending on how many users you have. On our Pro Edition, Pro Plan, it is $39 a month. Our nonprofit discount is the first 3 months of your plan for free. On our Enterprise, it is a 20% discount for the year. Or, well, is it yearly? I'm not sure. I think it's 20%.
Okay. I have a question here about how to gather the Salesforce IDs for records. It's not really a FormAssembly specific question, but you want to show how to get an ID. So basically, if you go to any record in Salesforce, you can see the ID embedded in the URL. So you can use that. I think that's probably the easiest way to get that. Another question here. We have a lot of questions coming up. Are you able to use this as a quiz tool so you can immediately or via email tell the user what they got right or wrong?
We have a calculation feature that we have people. Now, this isn't something that should be used on a very,
very complex quiz.
But it's not secure. Because if people know JavaScript, you know, they can change things. So if it's a very important, you know, semester final quiz or test or something like that, probably not suggested. But if it's a short 10 question, you know, something like that, it's very easy to use our calculations.
Yeah. One more thing I want to add is, in addition to the calculations in FormAssembly, once you send the information to Salesforce, you can trigger automatic workflow and emails based on the information in Salesforce.
Real quick, I'm bringing up a contact record here. So if you look up here at the URL, that is the record ID for Mr. Bond.
I have a question here about integration with other databases, so PeopleSoft and Oracle. Do you guys have any integrations with them?
Not that I've worked on personally. That doesn't mean we don't. But they're not connectors. Again, it would be a possibility through our HTTP connector.
Right. And Roger, I also recommend you to consider Salesforce as a replacement for PeopleSoft. if the connector is running interactive mode and there is an error, what does their respondent see upon submission?
In interactive mode, they will get the Salesforce system error, which can make sense to some people, but many people just look at it and go, huh? And at that point, if they do not know how to fix it and resubmit the form themselves, it will be in the incomplete forms. So it will be saved in FormAssembly, but it is in our incomplete tab. And from there, here's one. From there, you can finalize the response, and then it will go through after that. So if there's still an error, you can go through and either fix it or send an email to the people so that they can finish it up or fix it, just depending on what's wrong. There's a lot of scenarios there.
I have a question here from Sarah. I think Sarah is thinking about accepting donations through FormAssembly. So she's asking about, can you set the connector so it creates a new opportunity record and then the contact roles within the opportunity record to associate them with the opportunity record?
Would the contact role be something like the record ID type?
No, the contact role is a kind of, it's a related object, but I can tell you from my experience that it's absolutely possible to do that. We have a few clients that are using that, and we create both the contact roles and other records. Okay, I have a few. We have more questions coming. I have a question from Roger. Could I enable an HTTP post from an internal form at our company to do FormAssembly generated form? Not sure I completely understand.
I would need a more scenario. But it's something, you know, you can also email Jarrett with that question. He'd be a great person to contact for something like that.
Can you mass change or reset credentials for all the forms?
Yes. Once you change one in the connector where I put my security token, Salesforce password, and Salesforce username, once you update one, a link will show up below that says, you know, do you want to change the rest of your forms with this username? Do you want to update the rest of the credentials? And so once you click that link, it will update them. You can only update someone else's forms if they're shared with you or if you have their login information.
Great. And I think that's our last question. So we're going to finish right on time. Hillary, I really appreciate your time today. It was a great demo. Thank you so much for joining our Apps for Good webinar series. Please check our website for additional webinars and let us know if you have any questions or suggestions. We will send you the recorded webinar probably in a few hours, and we're going to publish it to YouTube and to our website as well. Thank you for your time.
Wonderful. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Tal. It's been good. Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you. Please stand by.